goes by the pseudonym Bo Snerdley.
It's time for the Soul of Excellence.
He is a radio host at 77 WABC here in New York.
The Rush Hour is on the air.
Rush, Rush.
Now here's Bo Snerdley on the Red Apple Podcast Network.
Welcome, my friends, to the Monday edition of Bo Snerdley's Rush Hour here on 77 WABC. If you would like to be on the program today, 800-848-9222 is how you reach us, 800-848-9222. It is October 7th. I know where I was at this time a year ago. It was a Saturday. I was in the studio. With me was one of my dearest friends in the world. He was in Israel. His name is Joel Rosenberg. He is the founder and editor-in-chief of All Israel News. Prior to that, many, many years ago, when we were both very young, he's still younger than I am, he was working with us on the Rush Limbaugh program. He was Rush's man in Washington. Joel has since then become a world-renowned author, a best-selling author. I can't even keep up with the number of books. He's a prolific writer, all of them bestsellers. Many of them have accurately predicted, even though they're novels, events that took place in the world later, particularly in the Mideast. Joel has many hats. His political acumen is incredible. He's covered the war from the beginning in Israel. He has been inside Gaza, inside the terror tunnels. He's interviewed hostage families. He's met with Prime Minister Netanyahu and so many other Saudi and other Gulf leaders. Welcome, my dear friend, Joel. How are you today?
Bo, it's hard to call you Bo, but I'm just going to call you James.
You call me James, everybody.
I love you, and I'm so grateful for your friendship. And you're right. I think you're the first person I talked to outside my family, the first media person I talked to on that morning, of October 7th, it was a brutal, cruel day, and you immediately got in touch with me and asked me to come on the show, and I was honored to do it.
Joel, this year, I don't even know whether it can be summed up in an hour or many hours, what has taken place. We have seen inside our homeland here in the United States of America, anti-Semitism raise its head. To me, I'm appalled by what I've seen coming out of American college campuses. Israel is still fighting for its very existence, and I must say they are doing a masterful job. But the threats to Israel still remain. Iran is still the big power that needs to be checked in the region. Your assessment of life in Israel and what has happened during this year?
Yeah, James, we got blindsided by the Hamas invasion of about 6,000 terrorists on October 7th last year. We didn't see it coming. Israel's greatest intelligence failure was a catastrophic failure. Israel was focused on the Iranian leadership and the regime and that threat and the Hezbollah threat in Lebanon and considered the Hamas terrorist organization a tension to be managed, not a problem to be solved. And so they just weren't giving creativity or effort or even hardly any, you know, focus on it. Over the last year, it has been, you know, I've said it many times, I've said it on your show, Israel has been living through our darkest hour. And because, you know, we didn't see more Jews killed in a single day during the Holocaust. That was, but October 7th was the worst day in all of Jewish history in the modern era post-Holocaust. And we didn't have a state back then, but we have one today. And where was it on October 7th? But to Israel's credit, you know, there's been a lot of soul-searching and recriminations, to be sure. But Israel has rallied. And where are we now? Where are we now? I mean, there's a lot of criticism of Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu. Some of it's valid, but some of it is not. But I'll tell you, he has become the Winston Churchill of this fight. The war against Hamas is over in Gaza. Now, there'll be mop-up operations. There's still terrorists there, and they have some caches of weapons here and there. But effectively, Hamas's back has been broken. They've been shattered. In Lebanon, nobody saw that Israel could do what it just did in the last month. Israel took out 18 of the top 18 terror leaders of Hezbollah in a few days, including assassinating the head, the demonic head of Hezbollah, Sheikh Hassan Nasrallah, who had run that organization for 32 years. And then Israel took out the next top 4,000 terrorists, leaders and commanders of Hezbollah, right, with those explosive
pages. The pagers
and walkie-talkies.
Yes.
That's just genius.
Joel, let me just stop you there for one moment.
Yeah.
When that story broke, I think the entire world marveled. How could they do this? That was day one when the pagers went off. Then when the walkie-talkies went off, it just went into overdrive.
Yes.
You are dealing with a sophisticated intelligence service like the world has never seen before.
Yeah, if I'd written a political thriller in which that happened, my publisher wouldn't have published it, and you probably wouldn't even have had me on, even though you love me, because it would have seemed ridiculous. I mean, Joel, come on. Yeah, you can make up anything, but you can't make up the total destruction of the top 4,018 people in a terrorist organization in like a 3-day period. It can't happen. So don't be ridiculous. But it happened, and now U.S. and Israeli intelligence estimates say that Israel is now over the past month destroyed 50% of Hezbollah's missile arsenal. Now, there's a lot to go, right? Because that, you know, they had about 150,000 missiles, so maybe there's 75,000 left. And we've gotten hit by about 200 of them today. But why haven't we been hit with 30,000 today? And the reason is because the entire command and control structure of Hezbollah has been shattered. Like, nobody wants to touch a phone in Hezbollah. Nobody can touch a pager or a walkie-talkie. So what are they using, Morse code? People are just making decisions on their own to shoot, but a lot of those people are dead or wounded. So, and now the attention's turning to Iran. And I think, James, that we are in the most dangerous moment of the war over the past year because with Hamas neutralized and Hezbollah reeling, now there's the first time that we've had an open shot to have Israel decapitate the Iranian leadership, neutralize the Iranian nuclear weapons program, and destroy Iran's oil refinery capacities, cutting off the money that is funding the nuclear weapons program and the terror system. So, but President Biden, Vice President Harris are putting enormous, unprecedented pressure on Prime Minister Netanyahu to stand down, to accept a ceasefire. And what they mean by that in plain English is to surrender. And this is Netanyahu's test. Will he surrender or will he pull the trigger on Tehran? I think he's going to pull the trigger, and it might be in the next few hours. I don't know exactly when, of course, but I think this is the moment. And I interviewed former Israeli Prime Minister Naftali Bennett last week, who is the most popular leader in Israel, and he would be the prime minister right now if there were elections. He's a former prime minister. He's not in government, but he's Netanyahu's main rival. And Bennett told me this is the moment, Joel. We've got to go and destroy the Iranian leadership and topple that regime before they get the bomb, which means he's saying to Netanyahu, even though I oppose you, I support you if you'll do this, And pretty much left and right, up and down the system, there's total unanimity to strike now, strike hard, strike fast. It's just that our main ally, the American government, is against us, as well as the British and the French and the UN. And, you know, that we expect in a sense. But, wow, Israel is going it alone. And that, you know, we can talk about how successful Israel's being at going it alone. But it's a scary place to be when you're a country of 10 million people and your main ally is the world's only superpower. But that superpower is being led by cowards.
It's Joe, you say cowards. I want to explore what is really going on with this. I'm going to take you back to the Obama years, where billions of dollars in cash were handed to the Iranians. I want to take you back to Biden's first term, where more money, critical funds, were sent to Iran. Is the position of, and I'm going to just make it political because it is. Why are the leaders in the Democrat Party so intent on seeing the number one sponsor of terrorism have nuclear capabilities and be able to continue threatening the very existence of Israel? Why would they do this?
Yeah, there's two possible answers, right? Just analytically, one, they're trying to destroy America by strengthening our enemies. The other is incompetence, and I will tell you that I still go with incompetence. I think Biden and Harris, you know, I think they're just idiots and they're cowards and they don't believe in winning. And so I think they genuinely have believed that you could cajole the Iranian regime back onto the on-ramp to get on the highway of, you know, of friendly international, you know, relations. They're just dead on wrong. But all their policies also have a negative effect, which is anti-American and anti-Israel. I don't think they are anti, except that their values are so wrong, their instincts are so wrong, that the effect is to be anti-American and anti-Israel. I was just on a radio show just a little while ago. Someone said, you know, Vice President Harris is an anti-Semite. I said, no, that's not really fair. She married a Jewish man. But when you so don't understand the nature and threat of evil, when you think that evangelicals and conservatives are evil, but the Iranian regime is not, then you've got a major problem. And it's leading Biden and Harris to terrible choices. We all saw this at the beginning. The best case example, option one on the table is we fought for 20 years against Al-Qaeda and the Taliban in Afghanistan. And then when everybody told Biden, don't do it, he pulled the Jenga stick out of the game on the 20th anniversary of 9/11. Everyone told him that's going to collapse the democratically elected weak but at least relatively moderate government of Afghanistan, it's going to crumble and the Taliban will take back over. Now, he just didn't get it. But that weakness and that incompetence matched with his hubris that he's better at it than everybody, that's a dangerous cocktail, incompetence mixed with hubris. But you know, Harris is drinking the same cocktail. And that's what puts us in such mortal jeopardy as a nation, and obviously for Israelis too, if in a few weeks Harris becomes the commander-in-chief, we're in for the most dangerous 4 years of our existence.
Joel, I'm going to take a break here. I would like you to stay on for another segment with me, please. Joel, sure. Rosenberg is here, founder, editor-in-chief of All Israel News. My dear friend, and wow, what is going on 1 year later? This was the equivalent of Israel's 9/11, and it has to be looked from that perspective. Birthday today, David Hope from the American rock band Kansas. Hard to believe this was 1978, but it was. Went to number three on the charts, Dust in the Wind. Happy birthday to David Hope. James Golden, Bo Snerdley, here with you on WABC 800-848-9222.
Same old song. Just a drop of water in an endless sea. All we do crumbles to the ground, though we refuse to see. Dust in the wind. All we are is dust in the wind.
Hour is on the air. Attention Ditto Heads. Attention Bo Scouts.
Rush
on the Red Apple Podcast Network.
This is my favorite of her solo works. Annie Lennox. On this day in 2013, Annie Lennox described the sexualized imagery of modern pop videos as dark and pornographic. She told the BBC she's all for the freedom of expression, but what is on the market is clearly one step beyond. It's clearly into the realm of porn. She called for music videos to be rated. If you think it was bad in 2013, it's worse today. Annie Lennox. With me, Joel Rosenberg. Joel, where can people find All Israel News?
Yeah, you can go to allisrael.com. Again, allisrael.com. You can sign up for our free email daily newsletter. You'll get all the top headlines. Basically, we have created an entirely new system of journalism in Israel, which is what I call the George Costanza doctrine of journalism. Whatever the mainstream media does, do the opposite. And that's why we're surging in traffic, because we're credible. We're doing the exact opposite of everything that's happening in the horrific mainstream media, which has been, you know, exposed as even more horrific, not just in this election cycle, but during this war.
Where do you see this all going, Joel? Where do you see? I was reading a Washington Post article today that said that now that Israel is on the counterattack, they are preparing to be at war for years. Do you see this war going on for years?
I do not, because Israel does not have a doctrine that will allow us to fight for years. That's why we're about to go for the knockout blow, I believe. Because remember, Israeli security doctrine believes that America will be standing with us through all of our wars. And so we're grateful as Israelis that the American people, you know, have, you know, in this war have passed through Congress more than $26 billion worth of funding. But what happens with that funding? Well, what happens is American defense contractors build the weapons that we use. Now, we adapt them somewhat, we improve them, but it's all built by American workers with American taxpayer dollars because we're fighting America's enemies. The problem is, James, that we've never imagined a scenario in which America would not be with us, that the president of the United States and the vice president would effectively be stopping or slowing down the flow of weapons and ammunition to us during a live, hot war on seven fronts in order to leverage us to surrender. And so we're going to run out of ammunition. We're going to run out of missiles. And so we're about to go for the kill shot, I believe. And it's a scary place to be. Now, for me, as an evangelical, I believe what the Bible teaches, that God is with Israel, even when we struggle as Israelis. Not every Israeli believes in God or walking with God or reading the Bible. But God loves us anyway. And in this case, he's not going to allow us to be eradicated or annihilated. But but we can't wait for Washington, because we have to defeat and destroy the Iranian regime and nuclear and oil systems Why? Because we have to end this war. We can't go on forever. And I think 6 months or a year from now, you're going to have me on the show on WABC, right, the blowtorch of New York City, and you're going to say, Joel, you predicted on my show that Israel would be seen as the superpower par excellence in the Middle East a few months ago, and that the Saudis would make peace with Israel once we won this war, that possibly even the Lebanese would make peace when you win this war, and now here we are. I think that's where we're headed, but it could be very dark and messy between now and then.
Well, Joel, I'm going to certainly extend the invitation to you. I also would like to extend, aside from talking about this ever-important war in Israel, I want to have you back before the election, if possible, to talk about American politics, because there's a lot going on here. In fact, you know, today, I got to stop real quick, but today, the Merchant of Death, that Joe Biden and Kamala Harris let out to get our precious WNBA basketball player back, the Merchant of Death, guess what he's doing? He's back selling weapons. He's back selling weapons. Absolutely. Joel
mercy,
Rosenberg, once again, tell people how they can get a hold of All Israel News.
Yeah, you can go to allisrael.com. Again, allisrael.com. And, of course, you can follow me on social media, X at Joel C. Rosenberg.
Joel, thank you for spending so much time with us. We appreciate you, and I love
you,
Joel.
It's an honor, my
friend.
Bless you. Thank you.
Diego.
Yes, on this day in 1995, a lot of sports set went number one on the U.S. album chart with her third album, Jagged Little Pill. The record produced six successful singles, including You Oughta Know, Ironic, which is what you're listening to now, You Learn, Hand in My Pocket, Head Over Feet, and went on to become the biggest selling album ever by a female artist with sales of over 30 million copies on this day in 1995. Alanis Morissette.
Checking in with Kim Komando in traffic, coming back. James Goldman, Bo Snerdley. One of my friends is supposed to give us a call from Israel. Maybe he'll give us a buzz. And then your phone calls, of course, are coming up. And we'll touch on what's going on with American politics, too. So keep it right here on this October 7th. James Golden, Bo Snerdley.
Hour with Bo Snerdley.
Goes by the pseudonym Bo Snerdley.
Rush.
Now here's Bo Snerdley.
1976, on this date, John Lennon awarded his green card. He was a legal migrant to the United States. The permanent residency status in a hearing in New York City overturned previous efforts by the government to deport him. Can you imagine? They wanted to deport John Lennon. A three-judge of the U.S. Appeals Court ruled that his 1968 arrest in Britain for possession of marijuana was contrary to U.S. ideas of due process and was invalid as a means of banishing him from America. So we kept John Lennon. On this day in 1976. James Golden, a.k.a. Snerdy, with you. Kamala Harris was on 60 Minutes. And, well, here's a little excerpt for your ears.
My plan is about that when you invest in small businesses, you invest in the middle class, and you strengthen America's economy. Small businesses are part of the backbone of America's economy.
But pardon me, Madam Vice President. The question was,
Pardon me.
How are you going to pay for it?
Well,
one of the things is I'm going to make sure that the richest among us who can afford it pay their fair share in taxes. It is not right that teachers and nurses and firefighters are paying a higher tax rate than billionaires and the biggest corporations.
But
I plan on making that fair.
But we're dealing with the real world here.
But the real world includes...
How are you going to get this through Congress?
You know, when you talk quietly with a lot of folks in Congress, they know exactly what I'm talking about because their constituents know exactly what I'm talking about. Their constituents are those firefighters and teachers and nurses.
Simple question. How are you going to pay for it? Well, when you talk quietly, members of Congress know what I'm talking about. Here is the truth. She doesn't even know what she's talking about. It's just one slogan after another. We're going to make the rich pay their fair share of taxes. I got news for you. The rich have been paying over their fair share of taxes in America for decades. How can you say that easy? Because it's true. If you look at the upper top of the income scale, and then you contrast that to the total amount of taxes paid, the rich pay the overwhelming amount of money going into the U.S. Treasury. Now, if you want to tell me that we need to straighten out some of the tax code, okay, I'm fine with that. But this repeated lie that comes up every election cycle, we're going to make the rich pay their fair share of taxes. You're going to make Nancy Pelosi pay more? By the way, you're going to make yourself pay more, Kamala? Nothing stops you, Ms. Harris, from writing a check to the government if you think you're not paying because you are the rich. Nothing's stopping you from writing an additional check to pay for some of this stuff. Anyway, it's typical. An NBC correspondent that you know well, Andrea Mitchell, NBC News, said that Vice President Kamala Harris has a big problem with men. She got a problem with one of her men slapping around women, but that's not anyway. National polls show Harris with a slight lead over Donald Trump. On Meet the Depressed, Mitchell emphasized that Harris's campaign needs to double down. I think they've got to double down on doing more interviews, serious interviews. She can't. This was a serious interview with 60 Minutes, and what do you get out of her mouth? Nothing but pablum. Because what I'm hearing from Democrats and Republican business people and a lot of men, she's got such a big problem with men. I think there's an undercount of the Trump vote. This is coming from her ally. She's got a problem because this non-existent plan that she has. How are you going to fix the economy, Kamala? Well, we're going to talk quietly to Congress because they know what I'm talking about. We're going to make the rich pay their fair share of taxes. We're going to stop price gouging. Do you have any proof that price gouging exists? We're going to stop price gouging. We're going to make people pay their fair share of taxes. How are you going to get it through Congress? We're going to talk to them quietly. Folks, this is utter political. I'm not calling her stupid, but I'm saying what she's saying is utter political stupidity. We're going to talk to Congress. Oh, so if Republicans hold the House, if Republicans get the Senate, you're going to talk to Republicans quietly and talk to and quietly because they understand. And they're going to switch their what they would be and say, oh, yeah, let's go out under the Republican banner and implement more and more and more and more taxes to pay for your nonsense. Oh, yes. And we're going to defeat price gouging. This is insanity. There is no economic plan because she can't come up with one. If there is one that someone wrote for her, she can't articulate it because she doesn't understand the economy. She doesn't understand how it works. All you get is sloganeering from her. Now, at the same time, NBC Indra Mitchell was admitting that Kamala Harris has a big problem with men, except the one that she has who likes to slap around women. Another one of their talking heads, Kirsten Welker, this, oh, stop it, James, don't be mean. Let me just say this. I remember when Tim Russert used to run, was on Meet the Press and used to run the show. He was pretty much the news head honcho at NBC News. And I think old, with his charts and everything else that used to infuriate some of us, what we would give to have Tim Russert back. Because what has been on NBC Sunday News, is I stopped even watching the Sunday shows. I used to watch them religiously. But this Kirsten Walker, Welker, whatever her name is. Ugh. So you heard, and she said, you heard Andrea Mitchell, who was on with her this week, said that Kamala has a big problem with men. Now, also in the same broadcast, what they're saying is misogynation is responsible for Kamala Harris's poor performance with men. It's misogynation. It's that men are inherently biased against her because she's a woman. They're not. They're not. Men, businessmen, are behind her because their obligation is to conduct business. And what they're hearing from cackles is a lot of nonsense. You can always blame whatever. You don't like it. Blame the race card. Blame the gender card. Oh, men are just biased. They don't want a strong... That's garbage. Men, especially those that run companies, have one allegiance. It's to the P word. And that's not the P word many of you might think I'm talking about. It's the P word that's profits. Profits. They want to know how their business is going to profit. They don't care about the other P word when it comes to profits. And Kamala Harris is giving them absolutely nothing. Oh, Diego stopped me in time because I was just going to keep ranting. Instead, we have to say happy birthday to Kevin Godley. Now, what a great name to have. What's your last name? Godley. What a great name to have if you behave properly, I should say. Drums, vocals for 10cc. Today is his birthday, Mr. Godley. Happy birthday. James Golden, Bo Snerdley, checking in with the markets, and your calls are coming right up. Keep it right here and do not go away. You got it made. I'm not in love. No, no.
Rush.
It's the Rush Hour with Bo Snerdley on the Red Apple Podcast Network.
Main ingredient. Bring us back.
Hey, wait a minute. Where are you going with that suitcase?
Tony Sylvester, one of the singers with Main Ingredient. Born on this day. So many hits from them, of course. This one. And Everybody Plays the Fool, I think, might have been their biggest one. That is the lead singer, Cuba Gooding Sr. Yes, that's Cuba Gooding's dad. He was the lead singer for The Main Ingredient. Cuba Gooding Sr., one of the best voices in the business. Anyway, ladies and gentlemen, it is time.
James Golden, a.k.a. Bo Snerdley, presents Rapid Phones.
Let's start with Greg in New Jersey. Greg, what is on your mind this afternoon?
Hi, Bo. We're in a spiritual battle here, you know, and it sounds like Israel's going to Gulf broke, maybe tonight. I hope they do, because they're not getting support from Amala and what's his name. All they're doing is robbing and stealing everything they can get their hands on. But there's actually a prayer. It's a long prayer, and I don't want to say because it takes over a minute. But if people Google the prayer to the consecration of America, you know, once we straighten ourselves out top down, you know, hopefully we'll be okay, because we're in bad shape right now. We got to get rid of these Democrats.
We have 1 month, less than a month, to go, and I hope many people hear your message. Thank you so much for the call, Greg. Robert in Brooklyn, New York, you're up next.
Hi, thanks for taking my call. I want to applaud Donald Trump for visiting the cemetery of the Lubavitcher Rebbe today, especially on this day today. Dove Hyken retweeted that Kamala Harris and Walt, they declined the invitation. Also, the horrific treatment of the victims in Hawaii, Ohio, and now the hurricane victims in North Carolina, they treated them horribly. They have trillions of dollars for China. They have hundreds of billions for Russia, Iran, and Ukraine, billions for everybody else. But they could only say $750 for victims in North Carolina. Shame on Harris and Biden. Shame on them.
Absolutely. Tom in Woodbridge, New Jersey. Tom, make it quick. Yes. Time's running.
Yes, with regard to the Israel conflict going on in Lebanon and the West Bank, Gaza, etc., I think that we should not be antagonizing either side. The best course of action for the United States to maintain its own national security is to maintain a policy of neutrality in the region. And that includes
neutrality. So in other words, let Iran continue to build the weapons to not only destroy Israel, but to dominate the entire Middle East is your policy.
Well, how many people even know that Israel has an illegal nuclear arsenal of over 200 warheads?
They don't have an illegal nuclear arsenal. They have a nuclear arsenal. They have a nuclear arsenal, we suspect, and they need one. What's next?
U.S. technology.
Look, so what?
The Apollo affair.
Somebody's got to be. Look, pal. I know that you don't really like Israel as a nation state. We get that, Tom. We listen to your calls. We know where you're coming from. But sadly, you're in the minority. Okay? Love hearing from you, Tom, always, even though you and I disagree on this. Silas in Staten Island, you're up next.
Yeah, I have a total disagree that. You know, the guy you're talking
about. Your line is breaking up. I'm sorry. We're going to have to try again. The line's breaking up. Let's go to Edward in New York City. You're up next. Edward, how are you?
Mr. Snerdley, thank you so much for taking my call. And thank you for the main ingredient song. That took me back. I love your taste in music in between all your information.
Thank you. What's on your mind?
I want to know if you think it's going to be a net loss or a net negative or a net positive when Mayor Adams finally steps down as mayor of the city of New York.
I hope he doesn't step down anytime soon. You do not want the number two guy. You don't want him. And by the way, I believe in the presumption of innocence. Let him fight the charges. If he's found guilty, well, c'est la vie. If he's found innocent, why should he step down? So I hope that Mayor Adams does not succumb to all of the pressure and that he stays put. That's what I hope. Appreciate it. Long Island, let us check in with Carol. How are you this afternoon, Carol?
Yeah, hi. They keep on saying about that fair share taxes, but it's according to their own laws that they've passed for decades and decades, aren't they just paying what they're set up to pay?
Yes, exactly. Yes, Congress made the tax code. They are paying what Congress has set forth to them to pay. And again, if you look at the quintiles of who pays, the very top tax bracket pays upwards over half the taxes in this country. Well over half. We have to go, sadly. Ah, yes, my friends, may God bless and protect each and every single one of you, your families, your loved ones. Love and gratitude for your being here with me and allowing me to be with you. God willing, we are back tomorrow for the Tuesday edition of Bo Snerdley's Rush Hour. Until then, my friends, I bid you adieu. Bye.